थैंक यू दुबे सर फॉर गिविंग दिस अपॉर्चुनिटी। और फिर तपन के बारे में क्या बोलना है जिसके 7 लाख लिंक्डइन के फॉलोअर्स हो एंड द पर्सन हु हैज बीन डिजिग्नेटेड एज वन ऑफ द इन्फ्लुएंसर ऑन द लिंक्डइन प्रोफाइल। वो तो वही बात है ना जो हिंदी फिल्मों का डायलॉग है कि नाम ही काफी है। तो यहाँ जितने भी लोग ऑडियंस में है एवरीवन इज द फॉलोअर एंड फैन ऑफ तपन सिंघल। एंड आई एम श्योर कि थोड़ा सा मैं इनके निगेटिव बारे में बोल दूं, आई एम श्योर कि ही मे नॉट बी लाइक बाय हिज पीयर ग्रुप। पीयर ग्रुप मतलब जो सीईओ का जो क्लब होगा, बिकॉज ही इज द जेंटलमैन हु इज जनरेटिंग अंडरराइटिंग प्रॉफिट। ये इंश्योरेंस पार्टनर से बड़ा कम देखने को मिलता है, क्वार्टर आफ्टर क्वार्टर, ईयर आफ्टर ईयर। और इनके जो दोस्त लोग हैं सीईओ लोग, उनको बोर्ड मीटिंग में बहुत कुछ सुनना पड़ता होगा इनके कारण। दिस जेंटलमैन अगेन क्रिएट ट्रबल्स फॉर बिजनेस स्कूल लाइक अस। ही वेरी प्राउडली फ्लैशेस हिज नॉन एमबीए क्वालिफिकेशन टू ऑल द प्लेटफॉर्म्स। मैंने इनसे कई बार रिक्वेस्ट किया कि भाई जरा इसको डाउन प्ले करो वरना हमारे यहाँ एडमिशन होना बंद हो जाएगा। बट एनीवे आई एम वेरी प्राउड दैट ही इज बेसिकली एमएससी फिजिक्स इन स्पेक्ट्रोस्कोपी एंड लेजर स्पेक्ट्रोस्कोपी। और यहाँ जितने भी साइंस के लोग हैं जानते होंगे कि लेजर इज नथिंग बट वेरी फोकस्ड लाइट बीम। एंड आई परहैप्स दैट स्टडी हैज मेड हिम व्हाट तपन इज राइट नाउ, आई मीन ए नोन पर्सन, वेरी फोकस्ड अटेंशन। ही इज वेरी मच ऑब्सेस्ड विद थ्री थिंग्स: टेक्नोलॉजी, कस्टमर सेंट्रिसिटी एंड द केयरिंग फॉर अदर्स। एंड आई बिलीव दिस थ्री थिंग्स टूगेदर पुट टूगेदर हैज मेड व्हाट बेसिक इज ऑल अबाउट, व्हाट तपन सिंघल इज ऑल अबाउट। ऑफ लेट आई एम फाइंडिंग दैट ही इज टॉकिंग लेस ऑफ इंश्योरेंस मोर ऑफ स्पिरिचुअलिटी। बड़ी बड़ी बातें कर रहे हैं अपने लेख में, अपने माइंडफुलनेस, इनर वॉइस। तो पता नहीं, जनरली हम जब बच्चे आते हैं इंटरव्यू लेने के, हम लोग पूछते हैं कि वेयर डू यू सी आफ्टर 5 ईयर। तो मेरा क्वेश्चन भी है तपन से कि आई डोंट नो, 4 साल बाद ये हम लोग को मिले हैं इंटरेक्शन के लिए, मे बी 4 साल बाद मिलेंगे तो वेदर ही विल बी ए ग्लोबल सीईओ प्लान्स और मे बी साउथ एशिया सीईओ और मे बी ही विल बी बाबा तपन दास ऑफ ऋषिकेश वाले। सो आई डोंट नो, बट या दिस इज व्हाट माय इनिशियल इंट्रोडक्शन इज। इनके प्रोफाइल सबको मालूम है सर, ग्रेट ह्यूमन बीइंग। अपने इनसे कोई इनके कंपनी में डरता नहीं है, चूंकि ये डराते ही नहीं है, सभी लोग इनको प्यार करते हैं। So many things to be told, but looking at the time constraint, sir, I stop here itself. Thank you, Tapan, for accepting our request and being here for us. Thank you very much.
Manoj, a personal question. आपका पुराना कितना नाता है?
Sir, 1985 से है, sir.
क्या 1985
में आप मिले थे? Sir, BHU में हम दोनों सब BSc साथ में पढ़े हैं, BSc Physics Honors.
Thank you. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Manoj ji, for a very interesting introduction. And I was also not aware of such multifaceted profile what Mr. Singhal has, and that only makes a person full who has got interest in spirituality. And maybe some other time I will have a one-on-one talk on this issue. So, without further ado, Mr. Singhal, over to you. You may speak whatever time, 10 minutes, 5 minutes, which you like. And then after that, I will take up some questions from the audience.
Thank you, Mr. Chaturvedi. Thank you, Mr. Dubey. And thank you, Manoj. Manoj obviously is a friend, so take his words with a pinch of salt. One thing which he has not told all of you is that we had failed in the first year in some papers in BSc, you know, so together. So if that gives you some comfort. So if you guys are failing somewhere, don't worry. In life, it's perfectly okay. We still can go ahead and become something in life. So, and we had great time together, one of my very close friends, and that is precisely why, you know, if he says something, I don't say no to him. Okay, now let's understand the circumstances and situation that we are in. First and foremost, I am a strong believer, and all my life I've been a strong believer in that the greater the obstacle, the more the glory in surmounting it. This is a very popular quote, you know, which has been said many times over. Now, COVID-19 is a huge obstacle. It will redefine the world like it has never been thought before. No? It will make so many things different from what you have seen and how things are going to be. And if you look before COVID-19 also, the world was in an economic slowdown mode. This has accelerated that particular part. No? Now, the way you look at jobs, the way you look at what you're doing, the way you look at the employment generation, all that will change. The interesting part would be, and I was telling this to some youngsters, that if we look at it from the year 91, when liberation happened in India, till now, 2018-19, it has been the golden era for India. In fact, toward 95-96 it started. India has been growing very aggressively. A lot of jobs got created. Youngsters got good jobs. Placement was very good. I think some people like us who remember before 90-91, a job was not easy. So if some of you youngsters ask your parents, they'll tell you how difficult it was to get a job in India before the year 1990. You know, you had to compete. You had to really be good in what you're doing, and then some people get a job. With the economic liberation, that became easy. Now, after COVID-19 and the economic slowdown, things is going to be very difficult. I think that is one thing that we have to clearly understand as you progress and as you move forward. And this is precisely when I thought, if I could speak to youngsters and answer their queries and give some insight into the way I look at the world, or I look at the business, and I look at what's going to happen in the near future, it would be a good interaction, because there would be doubts, there would be a lot of confusions, and there would be something that we have to figure out what to do. A lot of positivity also which has come through it, a lot of things which, if you look at from the environment perspective, if you look at from a perspective of digitalization, how things have moved, all that has become very, very positive from a customer centricity perspective. Those movements are happening. But at the same time, the stress for the smaller companies, SMEs, MSMEs, the business stress, redefinition is also happening at a very different level. If you look at in the past also, every big incident redefined the world. In fact, you'll be surprised to know that early on, the plague redefined and democracy came into existence. So every time when a major event happens, the world changes. The way business happens changes. No? If you look at, let's say, a year back, any startup would be talking of co-sharing, was talking of ride sharing, we're talking of work sharing. Now, in this era, will that work? Maybe no. No? How businesses redefine, how opportunities get created. Smart people see opportunities. Smart companies see opportunities. They become stronger. The greater the obstacle, the greater the glory in surmounting it. That is what it is. And all of you here, I wish that each one of you find it as an opportunity, get super excited about what new avenues are getting opened up, get super excited how to make a difference and how to be part of these new challenges. These opportunities come very, very less. One of my popular saying is that if you look at a Formula One race, when the road is straight, then it is not the driver which matters. It is the vehicle which matters. A good car would drive much fast in a straight road. In the curves is where a good driver makes a difference. These circumstances are like those curves. Good professionals, sharp thinking minds, good businessmen would make a huge difference to society, to the world, and to the people here. I'm very happy to take questions and answer each one of it, because the idea was more of interaction than a straight through one through webinar, because that I think is quite a few people are doing it. I thought, how can we be interactive? How can we answer any fear, apprehension, any question that you have from our perspective as to how do we see the country, the industry, and the world redefining itself. Thank you very much. Over to you. And Mr. Dubey, request that we can start the questions. No, and very happy to answer questions as it comes through.
Yeah, very well said. As a matter of fact, you have summarized both the positives and the negatives. So we need to look at the positive side and try to encash on this. So with these words, I will invite some questions here. Positive impacts, which you have already discussed, but there is a question around positive impact on insurance sector. I was wondering that why insurance companies did not launch a short-term 3 months term plan of 1 crore, okay? Only for the few contracted COVID, and I think they have lost a huge opportunity.
So, is that a question for me, sir?
Yeah, I'm just okay. I don't know anything about insurance. I'm just trying to walk you.
No, good.
But did you miss first out on the opportunity?
Yeah, first a disclaimer,
like
sir.
Arnab Goswami for some time.
No, but it'll be a pleasure. First a disclaimer, I am from the non-life industry, which is the PNC industry. So minus natural death, I cover everything. So this question belongs to the life industry. Having said that, let me attempt an answer, because I think that is an answer which would be valid again for non-life also. See, the issue is after a pandemic breaks out, no reinsurer is ready to give a cover in a reinsurance background. For a direct company, on the balance sheet, to take a huge risk, which is very uncertain in terms of how it plays out, would destroy the company completely. I think that is precisely why a lot of companies, even if they have a COVID cover which they're launching, they are launching with a restrictive number of covers they want to cover. So it is something like this. Let us say if a company on the balance sheet has 100 rupees, which it can afford to experiment with. So they will launch a cover which would be there for up to 100 rupees of loss that they can bear. That is how you have to do risk management. It should not happen that in terms of looking for an opportunity, you go overboard and you don't have a good reinsurance cover. And if things really go out of control, it kills the company. That is precisely why a lot of companies have hesitated for that. But having said that, if you look at in the health space, a lot of companies, including ours, have a COVID cover, which they have come out with. And one of our partners is actually selling a COVID cover every 3 minutes. Now, strong companies with stronger balance sheet would have a bigger spectrum of trying to experiment with this cover. But if you look at the way the cases are increasing, a pandemic is a very uncertain kind of scenario in which you really can't predict how it can blow out of proportion. And where will it move to? This is why they have not come out with a cover. I hope it answers your question, sir.
Yeah, I'm just trying to engage with you. But is there anything positive in the for the insurance industry?
Yes. So if I look at the insurance industry, and that is, it should be really heartwarming and like a kind of relief to all the insurance professionals and also the students studying insurance. If you look at the insurance industry, the impact on insurance industry because this pandemic would be one of the in the lower segments. It is not as bad as some of the other industries like airlines or malls or amphitheaters or movie theaters. The insurance will be one of the least hit. So if I look at general insurance in the different segments, if you look at health insurance, it's moving up. Even today, there is a growth of about 60-70% in health insurance business for the industry. So health insurance is growing up, which is about 20-25% industry. Automobile is down by about 40% for the industry. Now, that 40% down, one is the sales, which is not happening. Let us say, even if it opens up, vehicle sales hit a 50% down. But new vehicle in the portfolio of insurance industry would be just about 8% or so. So the total impact of it would be 4%. Now you see a 40% drop because a lot of customers are not insuring their vehicle. Because of two regulations or the ministry circular which has come through, which says that you can insure your vehicle till 21st of May and the continuity benefit will be given. Now, this is where people are missing it. They're feeling that the policy has got extended. The policy has not got extended. Even when on 21st May you renew your policy, it will be renewed from the date it was due. Let's say it was due on 20th of March. The whole premium for 20th of March will be charged, you know. So, but because it's confusion, about 30-40% automobile is down, which I feel will move up. So, if I look at the overall impact for the industry, crop insurance will happen, which is again about 18% or so. So, overall impact for the industry, if the whole year goes in a lockdown, will not be more than 10% or so. So, imagine where industries are getting wiped out, where they have no revenue and they're incurring losses by the day. If you look at the airline industry, I think one of those airline industry news I read, that person is losing about $10 million every day just doing nothing. And you can imagine $10 million you lose every day for doing nothing. If you look at most of the industry, they're suffering like crazy. And if you look at insurance industry and general insurance to be specific, the worst case scenario is that in the entire year, you would be negative 10% growth. Is it not phenomenal to be in an industry in which with such a huge risk, where the world is scared as to what will happen, where the economy is going for a toss, your industry maximum will go down by 10-15%. No, I think that should be a big relief and positive to all those in the industry and those especially trying to join the industry.
There are two questions which have come in the chat room, which I will just share with you.
One, I can read the chat, Mr. Dubey. You want to take the chat one?
Yeah. Why don't you take that?
Yeah. So one of it says that, do you think we need a pandemic risk pool in days to come to counter pandemic risk? No, I think it's a very good question. In my interview, in fact, I was the first to suggest this when we had industry meet along with CII, and they said there's no cover available for pandemic. So if I take you back to the 9/11 when terrorism happened and the Twin Towers came down, the entire reinsurance fraternity withdrew the terrorism risk. And in India, then we created a terrorism pool which actually played out very well. No, in fact, when the Bombay terrorism incident happened, the pool paid out for that. So, right now also, no reinsurer is willing to come out of the COVID pandemic cover. Some are talking of pandemic cover, but they're excluding COVID from that. So, in such a scenario, and now if you look at, we had SARS earlier, which also was, pandemic, but also was very high risk proof. I think this has been a pandemic because people who seem healthy are able to spread this. And it's also airborne also. And that is why it became a pandemic. So, when this is happening every 8-9 years, a new virus is getting discovered. It's high time for the country to look for a pool. So, I had proposed that and I fully support this idea and I'm pushing the industry as a solution because in the Indian market, we have to have a solution to be able to answer the risk which keeps on coming up. That is one which is there. The second question I can't see, sir. This was the one I saw. Anything else that you have here?
Okay, so it came in the private window, but before that, I have got Mr. Mohit Gulati from Marsh Broker. Are you there, Mohit? I have unmuted you.
Yes, sir, I'm very much here.
Yeah, please raise your question.
Good evening, Tapan sir, and good evening to everyone. Sir, my question is, as you just said, and we all know that this almost all the industries have been impacted by this pandemic situation, and it will definitely prolong. I mean, this is not going to over even after the lockdown. So we don't know how many months it will take to get the situation back to the where it was. Sir, as a broker, it would be difficult for us to sell any innovative product to client looking at the financial crunch. And so what should be the ideal and prudent approach to go to a client and approach for on the insurance needs of them?
See, I think the brokers play a very, very good role. And Marsh is an international broker, and you have a very large market share also, and you capture and you have very good customers. See, I think the first thing, let us understand the pandemic, and there's a lot of question also on the BI cover of business interruption because of pandemic. Is it covered, not covered, and what's going to happen on that? Let me explain that, and then you'll understand what role brokers can play. So, typically, a business interruption cover triggers off when you have material damage, which means, and if they have material damage cover. So, if there's a fire in the factory and the fire is covered, then the business interruption because of fire gets covered in the BI cover. I remember when floods happened and people could not access their call center or BPO, and because of lack of access, they lost revenue. At that time, a lot of customers requested for a cover on that basis, at least for discussion purposes. And that cover was available where loss of access to your premises and because of which any loss is going to happen will be covered. High interest. But today, if I look at if any customer has this cover, I am not aware of it. So the problem is when it comes to paying premium and the point you said, financial difficulty, the first place, if it is going to insurance where you want to save money, is the wrong thing to do. Because when things go wrong, it actually plays a big role to make you stand where you were before that. So this cover could have actually been got, when times were good. But that time when people are looking for the lowest cost is where the problem comes through. And that is where as a broker, I think the discussion that you should have with any customer even after pandemic is, that is it the lowest cost minimum cover that you want, or do you want protection of your balance sheet? If you had taken a cover for pandemic earlier when it was available in the market, then you would have been in a better situation today, or the saving of that money would have made a big difference. So I think this is the role of the broker, the right education to customers, taking and talking the difficult discussions to have. In fact, there's one example again I give, it was the Gujarat example. A CFO of a big unit in Gujarat. This is a way back story, not even today. I think much before most of you have joined the industry. So the floods had not happened in that area for about 100 years. The year he removed the FSTI cover is when the floods happened and he was sacked from his role. So a lot of CFOs, I tell them, would you want to be that CFO? No. And today, if let us say people or the board members come to know that a pandemic cover could have been purchased earlier and the CFOs did not purchase that, and that puts the company at risk. What kind of discussion I'm going to have? So the issue is this, as a broker, I think you have to have difficult discussions to bring the table, and the cost of insurance to the entire expenses of the organization is very, very low. I think putting that in the right perspective is what is very, very critical. So that is how you should be talking about it. In fact, it's an opportunity for you to have a lot of discussions about what can be done and what can be more secure going forward. And the biggest thing, if I were the broker, I would sell right now is the cyber cover. You see, all of us are on Zoom, unsecure. At an individual level, we don't have a cyber cover. At a company level, we are not fully secure. That some of us have it, not yet covered. Do we have this discussion? Do we bring into perspective what are the new risks? What are the most dangerous risks which can, you know, damage the balance sheet of the company? And do we discuss on that? That's the way I would take it. I hope it answered your question.
So, Mr. Tapan, there are two more questions in the chat. One from Swapnil and another one from... So, maybe we can, you can take them to answer. Then I will request Satvik Kant from asking question. But before that, just take these chat questions.
So one, it says, is as I have legal experience, I saw many data purchasers taking pretend of act of God, relative recovery from the market and more involvement in bad debts. So Swapnil, a lot of such cases start happening. In fact, there's an interesting thing also. I was talking to some of my counterparts in US. There are also chances of triggering of D&O claims. You know what? Investors in a company can actually think in US to file a claim against the debt of the company for not taking the adequate right decisions in a COVID kind of environment. So what you are saying, you'll see a lot of cases happening, and I'm not sure that most of them would really win the case, but litigations are definitely going to go up. So you have a point there. The next question I see is, what are the possible changes in distribution channels when we talk about insurance industry? Will there be new opportunities in such a situation? Contactless sales, remember this, all of us. If you don't understand how to do contactless sales in the future, whatever distribution network you have, you will not win this game. Simply because if you, let us put it like this, if you are in your home and today an insurance agent wants to come over to you, or an insurance salesperson wants to come to your home or to your office to sell, would you allow him or her access to come to you, sit next to you, have a cup of tea? Or will you call 3-4 insurance agents to talk to you? Will you sign up a proposal form that he gives you from his box? Will you, look at physical transactions happening now? So first and foremost, the answer is no from each one of us. Then what is the new way to sell is what the question should be there, which we should answer. How can contactless sales become the new normal is what we should ask. How can we see that even all distribution that we have, how can they do contactless sales is a question that we have to answer. You'll be happy to know that if I look at our company, Bajaj Allianz, and I think we were among the lucky because we had thought this lockdown would happen and we have prepared even before the lockdown. In fact, the good part was that we did our own lockdown to check our business continuity process. And second day of that, the Prime Minister announced a lockdown. So we were actually into it and we went to it. You will be happy to know that we issued 14 lakh policies and settled 8 lakh claims in the lockdown period. So contactless sales is happening. All distributions are firing in all cylinders. No, the issue is that if you're waiting for the 2nd of May, things will open. It'll be party time, carnival time again. Then you are mistaken. Even when it opens up on 2nd of May, it will still be in a scenario where social distancing has to be maintained. You have to be talking to customers and you will have to ensure that you are able to give them solutions for contactless sales. So that is one thing that you should be thinking about. In distribution redefinement, the critical point would be that the online channels should move up by about 15-20%, but other channels still remain because insurance is still distribution-led in India. Insurance is still sold on conversations. Insurance is not sold where the customer is looking for insurance and coming to you. It's still a push product, not a pull product. Till insurance is a push product, distribution will be required. 10-15 percentage points shift may happen, but mostly it will be there.
Okay, very, very well said. So let me take some change gear and invite some of the live audience. So Dr. Satvik Kant, I have unmuted you. Can you just ask?
Yes, sir. Good afternoon, sir. This is Satvik this side.
Go ahead, please.
My query is that, like you said in the initial part of the conversation, that a lot of companies are coming up with a standalone COVID-19 cover as per their appetite, obviously. But do you not feel that these companies, many of them, are rushing into this, just seeking this as an opportunity without understanding the impact and filing it under sandbox or use and file to get the UIN as early as possible and to mint the opportunity. And when WHO changing its norms and the number of debt that they projected, they are changing it on a weekly basis or fortnightly basis. We don't know the how big the impact would be. Then selling such insurance for very low price, is it a wise step to do?
Yeah, it's a good question. So, to understand how companies are doing it. So, if you look at the companies also, they come with this cover. Let's say they decide to sell about 1 lakh cover. Let's say at a 1 lakh cover, the sum insured is 50,000. So, in the worst case scenario, if the entire 1 lakh also triggers at 50,000, you're talking about over 3,000-4,000 crores maximum. So, what companies do it, they try to balance both. And if they see that things are going out of control, they withdraw it. But in a way, it gives them good branding. It also brings them into new tie-ups, and it also gets them an opportunity. But no company I have seen as yet is going completely berserk in an unlimited kind of sale of that. They have come out with products, but they are coming with a limited number of covers, looking at the appetite that they can handle. So these things, in a way, it's good also. In fact, the regulator also mentioned that companies should come out with COVID cover. And quite a few companies have responded to that, which is a good sign. The part which they have to be careful about is they should not go overboard in a way that if it goes out of control and it kills the company because they don't have reinsurance protection, that would be sad.
Okay, thank you, sir. I have got a question which came from the earlier list that is there any change in the consumer behavior post COVID-19? Do you think some behavior change?
Yes. See, what is going to happen? It's a very good question. Now, let us look at all of us. Now, I think when you look at consumers, most of us start looking outside and doing research. The first question when you look for consumer behavior is ask, how would we behave? So, let's look at our behavior. Most of us would be scared. Would we go and buy expensive stuff right now? No. Would we buy luxury cars? No. If I look at the Wuhan case also, the car sales went up is what the news came, but it went up for the lowest segment. People who started avoiding public transport are the ones who bought low-end cars, but high-end car sales has not gone up. So, I think most of the luxury spend would get impacted. People who try to conserve cash, people not be sure about how their jobs would be. Then, conservation cash, low-end sales would still continue. Public transport people would shun. Work from home will become a new normal. And specialization and looking at high productivity is what is going to happen. So consumer behavior will change a lot. Consumers will try and conserve cash. Spend on luxury items will come down drastically. Social gatherings would come down. And public transport usage is going to come down. So those things are going to happen at a very hyper speed. And after some time, people will start realizing. In fact, I was telling my HR head that if I look at work from home and if I look at the productivity, it has moved up. And a lot of my people are happy working from home. Why? Because let's say if I'm in Bombay and I travel 4 hours in a day just to go to office and come back. So imagine my life if I'm awake for, let us say, 17 hours. In 17 hours, if I remove, let's say, 2-3 hours of my daily activities, that is about 14 hours left. In 14 hours of my productive time, 4 hours of my life, I'm going to waste every day traveling, which means 25 to 28% of my life I'm wasting just commuting. And if I have a solution that I can work from home, why would I not work for a company which gives me the solution? Why am I going to waste my 20-25% of my life just on the street, commuting to work and back? Organizations will see that if they can get more productivity from work from home, why would they invest more in physical infrastructure and space? Those redefinition will happen. Customers' buying patterns will change. Job opportunities are going to get more, going to shrink more. EMIs will get impacted. So those would be the big changes that would happen, Mr. Dubey.
So this was a great understanding from you that in China, the people are buying smaller cars because the public transport they are avoiding. So which means that the new models which of Ola and Uber are going to be challenged.
Exactly, sir. That's why I mentioned, the most successful businesses just 3 months back are going to be the most challenged one. everybody looked at no sharing economy as the big buzzword. All startups, everybody is moving towards that. Today, who is looking at sharing economy anymore? It doesn't work. So that is why I say every crisis brings in different business models, brings in different opportunities, and smart people and smart businesses are going to find this opportunity and rule the roost.
I think we need to revise our case studies now with the because we have been talking about sharing economy too much. So this lighter note, I will move to Chandan. Chandan Thakur from Gulf Insurance. Are you, I put you unmuted, unmute Chandan, you can ask questions.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Hello, Tapan sir. My question is related to regulatory sandbox. How far IRDA regulatory sandbox has been successful during COVID-19? Do you think that the insurer needs more relaxation in the rule to be more innovative? And another question is related to the IRDA sandbox. IRDA is also looking for micro insurance. Okay, do you think that they can give some competition to traditional insurers in the line of business?
Okay, thank you, Chandan, for the question. So, in a way, when I was the chairman for the committee on e-commerce way back, I had recommended Sandbox that time, and I was very happy to see Sandbox come into existing and the regulator putting it on. In fact, they did it even before RBI, so that way they were very progressive in terms of coming to Sandbox. Quite a few approvals have come. In fact, the COVID approvals are coming in just 2 days' time. So I think in times of need, the regulator also rises to the occasion. But we have to give it to them that they have to also ensure that the policyholder protection is in place. And they have to also ensure that companies don't become cowboys and start issuing products which they can't service customers. So they have a difficult task of balancing these two parts. One is the speed of approvals. And second, looking at things if they go wrong, what how they protect the policyholder. So I think they have been maintaining that good balance and trenches they have been giving approval. So that point of from that point of view, they have been doing a good job, Chandan.
Good evening, Tapan sir. I have two queries. One on the technology side, and another is on the management, that is acquisition side. So I'll put crisp. The parametric insurance has basically seen as one of the alternatives for, you know, like where the conventional insurance arrangements do not give any coverage as such. So a lot of good reinsurers have come up with their solutions in this aspect for, you know, like solutioning to a specific particular requirement through the parametric solutions. So I am in a research orientation, I am just thinking if this can be an opportunity for us to think over as an alternative during this crisis and also post the crisis for the recovery. That is one question. Second question will be on the management side, where is it too early for us to discuss on the merger and acquisitions in Indian insurance industry, provided that the insurance regulator has only given advices to the companies as of now for maintaining suitable, you know, like the capitals and the solvency margins. But do you foresee any kind of change that may come in the solvency margin and the capital requirements? And do you foresee any M&As or in row for the industry?
Good question, Shiraj. I'm very impressed with Dubai. We have a lot of brilliant youngsters, no, on the call today. Okay, so let me answer your question, and then Chandan's question remains on the micro insurance and the threat to insurance companies. Let me put it together. Now, if I look at parametric cover, and if you look at some of my interviews in the past 3-4 years, I've been proposing that after the flood losses which I saw in the country, and in fact, much before, also I proposed for a common health scheme across the country. And I was very happy when our Prime Minister announced a common health scheme, a national scheme for everybody, because I used to say earlier, if you have a national scheme, the life expectancy of Indians will move by 4 to 5 years. And now I say that if you don't have parametric cover, it's also a social issue. A lot of people, if you look at, let's say, flood losses, if I look at Tamil Nadu, the insured losses was 4,000 crores. The economic loss was 20,000 crores. 16,000 crores were lost by the common person. No? And if somebody is at 50, 60 years and is in a nuclear family and everything gets wiped away, how will he or she build it up again? So a parametric solution is the best thing for the country. And I'm also happy to note that the Kerala government actually came out with a parametric, you know, conversation and was looking for a cover. The reinsurers are ready with it. As direct insurers, we are also ready with it. I've written to the regulator, I've written to the ministry also. I believe parametric cover is critical. It's going to solve a lot of social issues more than anything else, and we should be having it. Now, coming to merger acquisitions, there is stress. If I look at some of the companies in the market, and if I look at even the very old companies also, you will see that the solvency is under huge stress, and quite a few companies, as I hear from the market, are up for sale. But when you do a merger acquisition, what you're looking to is that, does it give you any benefit? What does it bring to the table? Does it bring you distribution? Does it bring you some special talent? Does it bring you... So if you don't have the answers, doing an M&A just for enhancing your macho image is the worst thing to do, because an M&A costs 2 years of real hard work integration. And if you look at M&As across the world and in all companies, you'll find 60-70% M&As fail. No? So it's not just a fancy thing to do. If you have surplus cash, you go and buy companies. When you buy companies, you should look into that. Does it add value to your existing company, and what does it bring to the table? If you don't get a clear answer, then just for being a macho player, don't do it. It causes a lot of stress and strain to the company. Chandran asked a question that with micro insurance coming in, it would hurt the traditional insurers. The good thing about insurance industry, Chandran, is that it is so big, it is so huge. There is enough space for everybody. Our penetration is still very low. So I keep on saying the more the merrier. I think all kinds of businesses, insurance should come, be it micro, more companies should come into the Indian market. The advantage would be the more people are covered, the more safe they are. No, we do not realize as insurers, we do social good. When we insure somebody, we actually do very good to that person. It is not about just sales. No, so the more, the better. I don't think it has come to a stage where it can be a threat to anybody. The threat to the insurance companies from their own business model, their own foolishness. If they burn up cash and if they get very aggressive and the solvency goes for a toss, so they are their own threat. The market is not a threat. It has enough opportunities.
So, good you have taken that question. Now, I have got some other discussion from the questions we have registered. Do you think this event insurance, you know, event insurance was something which as Indians we were always not very happy to do because it was extra cost. Last time I organized some marriage in my family, I say, oh, uska lene ka zarurat kya hai, kya hoga? But with all this happening, do you think there will be a surge of event insurance all across?
Good question, Mr. Dubey. So let me answer first to your marriage. We have actually a marriage cover also, which we devised in the year 2005-06, if I remember. And we're super excited that Indian marriages are expensive marriages and the cover will be sold well. But you like you rightly said, we didn't find much buyers. So when an event happens like this, the inquiries go up. And I remember when the floods happened, I used to feel that, okay, we have missed our duty as insurer to insure everybody. So at least let's start selling home insurance, no, in the area after the flood recedes and people have no settled down. My experience has shown that the first week after floods, there's huge spike in inquiries. After a month, the inquiry is same to where it was. And I asked this question to one of my psychologist friends. I find it very strange. Insurance products are so good, they're priced so well. People should be queuing up to buy insurance, no? And why it doesn't sell and why is it a push product? He gave a very beautiful answer. The human brain is not wired to see risk. See, if it was wired to see risk, all of us would still be living in caves. No? And the younger you are, the less wired you are to see risk. That is why you see youngsters driving at hyper speed. And as we get older, we stop driving at not over 30. So yeah. The problem is with the brain, the moment the risk is gone, it gets into the comfort zone and the insurance is out of the consideration. No? But that is the challenge also. How do we solve it as an industry? The challenge that people actually understand it is so beautiful to buy insurance cover. It does so much good to an individual, no? If you are well covered.
Very good. So I think you have answered my question because my family registered. They said, "Tum bura hi sochte ho." So they never let me because I thought it's a wise idea, you know, to at least.
Mr. Dubey, let me give an answer for my family which I gave to one of my friends, and then we move on. It's a very interesting thing. So one of my friends told me, "Ki taban dekh bhai, bala, 10 साल से प्रीमियम दे रहा हूँ कुछ होता नहीं है फालतू का तुम लोग ना पैसे ले आते हो सो आई टोल्ड हिम ओके लेट्स लुक एट इट फ्रॉम दिस पर्सपेक्टिव दैट आई स्टेप आउट ऑफ दिस कन्वर्सेशन एंड आई एम ऑन द रोड एंड अ व्हीकल हिट्स मी एंड आई गेट नो आई हैव एन एक्सीडेंट सो विल यू नॉट पे मनी टू टेक केयर ऑफ माय accident or hospital expenses, will you all not contribute as friends? What is the stupid question? We'll all pay money, no? Why will you hesitate? I said, that's exactly what you're doing today. You all are paying money for somebody who is having a misfortune. And God forbid that you are that person who receives the money. You are doing such a social good, just you do not know where your money is getting utilized. So next time you tell your family this, when I pay money for this, if something goes wrong, everybody is going to pay it to me. If it does not, we are helping somebody for whom things have gone wrong. No?
Beautiful.
I think next time they'll be very happy to pay premium, sir.
Yeah, very, very beautiful explanation. I think that's why it brings your spiritual side and the different side. So, Tapanji, we launched a program in our BIMTech insurance stream called InsureTech. Do you think, as a question also related to that, do you think there will be a more and more importance of InsureTech in India or future in India?
Okay. The first warning which I give when anybody talks to me, tech is not a fancy word to be displayed in board meetings. Tech is a tool to solve a problem. So if InsureTech has to be successful, they have to ask the question to themselves, what is the problem that we are solving? If their answer is clear, those InsureTechs will be successful. If their answer is not clear, and they're just trying to plug and play and no, sound fancy, that hum log startup kar rahe and we're doing InsureTech, then they'll not be successful. So I think just one basic question to be asked, tech is a tool to be used, a very powerful tool, but it's not solving a problem. It has no relevance. I think that is how it is. But InsureTech has a lot of future. A lot of things will happen in InsureTech. But if they are very clear about what problem they're solving, then they're going to be very successful.
So there is a question in the chat window from Govind Tripathi, sir. You can see. Maybe you can answer that.
No, sir. I think for me, the window is moving very fast. I kept a small window. So I can only see the last two ones.
Let me read out for you. So Jay Govind Tripathi, he says, he's asking question that three general insurance PSUs were expected to be merged shortly. What would be the impact on the COVID and the merger plan?
Such question you would ask a shareholder. In this case, the shareholder is the government. So I can give no answer for this because this is a decision which the government has to take, you know, because they are the shareholders for PSUs. They have to decide. A lot of questions has been raised earlier also of the merger and then how it is going to be done and the money to be put. The COVID impact right now, if I look at the balance sheet of the industry, will not be so negative till the health claims goes out of hand. But mostly, if you see, there will be lower cars in the road, so which means there will be lower car accidents. Most units are shut down. So, claim ratio will actually come down, which is beneficial for the general insurance industry. But if the health claims goes out of hand and they go out of control, that can really hurt the industry. So the COVID answer would depend on times to come as to how the claims pay out for the health part. Otherwise, I don't think that's going to cause more stress than where they already are in the future for some kind of knee-jerk reaction by the government.
Okay, thank you, sir. I have got Raghav Jain from SBI General. So Raghav, can you ask that question? I have unmuted you.
Yes. Hello, sir. Sir, as an insurance professional, I feel a bit sorry that we are not able to help our clients today. It matters the most. This is especially in the context of business interruption. Sir, do you see that opening of the market, especially in terms of policy wordings?
Yeah, there will be innovations happening. I think even now, when I look at it, some reinsurer talking about pandemic cover minus COVID. So those things start happening. I think what you have to feel sorry about is not serving them. See, it's a contract. So let us say if I have a contract with you, whatever is agreed on contract for what you have paid is what I will serve you. And that I should do well. That is how you should look at what you are serving. What you feel sorry about is that why could one, this not be, have been offered to the customer earlier? Two, if it was offered, why did they not take it? So in my experience, a lot of places we did, talking to customers earlier of access denial, cover, and quite a few customers did not take it, but it was expensive for them then. So if as a customer I have paid for a contract, so whatever is covered in that, we should pay very gracefully, very fast. But what is not covered in that, then is not payable. I think let us be clear on that. That is how the business model works. So what you have to think about is, again, speak to your customer, see what best cover can you give to them, and you should do that. But if they don't take the cover, then obviously they're taking the risk on their own, and they are evaluating from their perspective. So it is for them to do so. So as a good insurer, try and increase your penetration. And SBI is a very powerful, widespread bank. I think you have the maximum reach. You try and cover as much as possible the customers that you have. Because I always said the duty of the insurer is to ensure that everybody he or she meets has the best cover available that you offer to them, and they should be having it. Because once you have insured somebody, you have done social good, is my belief. So that is what you should know. After this, the biggest learning for you is that is every 100% SBI customer covered in the best manner is what you should be pushing for in times to come. And thank you, BIMTEC, for arranging it. And thank you, Manoj, my friend, for getting it. Thank you, Mr. Chaturvedi. And thank you, Mr. Dubey, for all that you have done. Thank you very much.